Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. It is Thursday, and what a week. What a week. What a week. That's okay. We're doing just fine. We are live from the bunker, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. It is Thursday, our last broadcast of the week. But that's no reason to skimp. And today we have a guest. Keith DeCandido is waiting in the wings. A couple of things here real quick. The live chat is open for anybody who wants to join the conversation. If you are watching or listening in replay, you can send us an email or leave a comment. Email address is livefromthebunker@sci-fi4me.com. And, of course, comments are open pretty much all the time. If you want to leave your thoughts. And if you would like to subscribe, if you're just finding us, whether it's a recommendation or somebody shared a link. By the way, those of you are sharing the link, right? If you're finding us just for the first time, welcome. We hope you consider subscribing to the channel. We've got lots of things here to watch and enjoy. Hopefully you enjoy it. And as part of that, we have negotiated, we've arranged over at superherostuff.com a discount code, sci-fi4me10, when you check out, and that will give you 10% off your order. It can be used in combination with some sales, but not everything. So it just depends on what they have going. But yeah, you save 10% off when you use the promo code sci-fi4me10. Now, first of all, just real quick, I want to get to this. This announcement has come across on YouTube and Twitter. Joe Jusko posting this. It is an announcement. John Buscema's daughter apparently posted this yesterday. 45 pieces of original Buscema artwork has apparently been stolen. They are in conversations with police. An investigation is going on right now, so they can't talk too much in detail. But just wanted to get that out there in case anybody is seeing any of this stuff. Of course, Walt Simonson posting it over on Twitter as well. So just wanted to just kind of give people a heads up that that is going on. And we'll see if maybe we can just kind of boost the signal there just a little bit. All right. So that is something I think is probably one of the more egregious violations that we see on things. You know, people faking artwork, people stealing artwork and selling it. You know, eBay is notorious for that kind of stuff. Hopefully they recover that without too much trouble. All right, so now let us bring on our guest, Mr. Keith R.A. DeCandido. How are you, sir?
I'm doing okay.
Well, welcome, and thanks for taking the time to talk with us. So it's always good to have you back. Keith was on here not too long ago on Deep Space Minds talking about Lower Decks. And I guess we could start there very briefly because you're also doing recaps for Discovery over on Tor's website.
Right. I've been, well, on Tor.com, which isn't, I mean, yes, it's owned by Tor Books, but it's really a pop culture webzine more than anything.
Right.
And I have been writing about Star Trek for Tor.com since 2011. And specifically since 2017, I have been reviewing each episode of the new Trek shows as they've come out. So I've reviewed every episode of Discovery, every episode of Short Treks, every episode of Picard, and every episode of Lower Decks. Currently, in fact, my review of this week's Discovery went up this morning, and of Forget Me Not, and that's up on Tor.com now. I've also been rewatching, and yes, there's the screenshot. I've also been rewatching the older Star Trek shows.
Right, you're in Voyager right now, aren't you?
Yes, yeah. And in fact, at the same time that this episode started, my my review of I blanked on the title. Concerning Flight went up. That is the Da Vinci Gone Wild episode.
OK. Okay.
That's every Monday and Thursday. I've already done complete rewatches of the original series, which included not just the 79 original series episodes, but also the 22 animated episodes and all 13 movies, but featuring the original crew. I did a Next Generation review. I did a rewatch. I did a Deep Space Nine rewatch. And I'm currently, as we just said, in the midst of a Voyager one. I'm in the middle of season 4 right now of Voyager. So I'm roughly halfway through.
Now, you're in a rather unique position there, because with watching all of these shows back to back to back to back to back to back, it's all fresh in your head. And there are people out there who, you know, they'll call up and, you know, they'll have instant recall of various different things. But now, having gone through all of that marathon, and now you're watching Discovery, and we talked about Lower Decks, honest opinion, how does New Trek stack up against Old Trek in your view? I mean, I know you're a little bit biased because you actually work in that universe. So you probably got to be careful not to bite the hand that feeds you, but
both have their good and their bad. It's funny. I resisted doing a Voyager rewatch for a long time because I wasn't that big a fan of the show.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up with the original series and loved it. I loved Next Generation. I loved Deep Space Nine. I did not love Voyager. But this year being the 25th anniversary, and for a number of other reasons, I decided to give it a shot anyway. And it's Voyager still has many of the same flaws that kept me from being able to get my arms around it 25 years ago. But it's got some great episodes too, and it's got some good characters. And ultimately, all of the Star Treks, both, you know, in the 60s, in the late 80s and 90s and early 2000s, and currently, all, whatever their flaws that they may have from episode to episode, usually have good, interesting, compelling characters and give us a generally hopeful future, one that is certainly better than the one we've got now. And that's been consistent throughout all of them. And I think the, even when they've had moments, you know, certainly, especially, you know, DS9 challenged, the hopeful future, how the original series challenged it a lot too. And both Discovery and Picard have done likewise, but it's still ultimately a better future than the present that we have. And it's one that gives hope for humanity, you know, and one, every single show defaults to compassion. Compassion right. is the way that the problems are solved.
Well, and I continue to see criticism, especially of Picard, that the tone has gone particularly nihilistic, I think, is one of the words that I've seen.
And there's an argument to be made for that, but ultimately, like I said, the crisis of the 10 episode first season was solved by not by taking up arms, not by fighting their way through it,
right.
not by, you know, doing something horrible, but by being nice to each other, by people accepting each other and being compassionate rather than being violent.
Right.
And even, you know, it was still a hopeful ending for all that the episodes leading up to it were a bit more dystopian than we've come to expect from the 24th century. But yeah, it I still think it worked, and I still think it was very much in keeping with the hopeful, because Star Trek, despite what Gene Roddenberry said later in life when he really, not to speak ill of the dead, but started to believe his own bullshit, the future of the original series was not quite as utopian as Next Gen in particular tried to portray it
right.
as. It was a better future, and it was a hopeful future, and it was humanity that was striving to improve itself and trying to moving past the bigotry, moving past the hatred, and still, you know, wasn't always perfect, but they did their best. And that's been true of all of them, you know. Perfection is not a state that you can really achieve, but it's one you can work toward. And the main characters in all the Star Treks have always striven toward that, one way or another, at least in overall.
Sure.
There have been individual cases where it hasn't been as much on all of the shows. But ultimately, it's still that hopeful future, and it's still that, you know, trying to solve the week's problems in ways that are not horrible.
No. Do you think, now going to Strange New Worlds, assuming that goes into production and we actually get that show and everything works out fine, you know, with all of the productions being delayed and shut down and back up and whatever, what's his name? Akiva Goldsman has said that one's going to go back to the more traditional episodic type of thing. And you just mentioned, you know, the episode of the week type of thing. As opposed to serialized storytelling like we got in Picard, like we're getting in Discovery. Is one better than the other? Does it matter? Does it depend on what kind of stories are being told? Which do you think, now that we've gotten both in Star Trek, is there one that you think works better in that universe?
No, there's no... The method by which you tell the story is less important than the story being told. One way is not intrinsically better than the other. That's silly. That's not how storytelling works.
Right.
I'm glad they're taking that approach with Stranger Worlds, just because it's different from the approach they're taking with the other shows. And the variety is part of what keeps things interesting, especially given... The only reason why we're looking forward to Strange New Worlds is because we spent the entirety of season two seeing how fantastic Anson Mount, Ethan Peck, and Rebecca Romijn were. There really isn't any great need for a Pike series in and of itself,
yeah.
But the three of them were just so good in the role. So, but having said that, it's still going to be basically another, these are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise. So I think making it different from these are the voyages of the Starship Discovery and different from what they're doing on Picard will help differentiate it from the other things they're doing on All Access.
Sure. Do you think going back to that kind of format might help with some of the people who have criticized Discovery and Picard for being that darker, grimdark, gritty, pessimistic tone?
Every time there's a new Star Trek, there are going to be people who are going to complain about it because it's not the Star Trek they grew up with and they don't like it. Yeah. This goes back to 1979 when people were complaining about the completely changed technology and the completely redone Klingons and the horrible new uniforms in the motion picture.
Sure.
It happened again in 1987 when Next Generation debuted and everybody said, how can you possibly do Star Trek without Kirk, Spock, and McCoy? That's blasphemy. And you did it again in Deep Space Nine debuted when it was like, well, how can it not be on a ship? And on and on and on.
Yeah.
Every time there's a new Trek show, there's always a contingent of the viewership who thinks it's horrible and thinks it's terrible and thinks it's not real Star Trek. Hell, Gene Roddenberry himself was going around to conventions in 1982 telling fans not to go see The Wrath of Khan because Nicholas Meyer didn't know anything about Star Trek, didn't understand his vision, and would absolutely ruin it, and it wouldn't be real Star Trek.
Right.
Nothing changed. And of course, he stopped doing that once everybody saw the movie and liked it. But you know, when something lasts as long as this has, there's always going to be people for whom something was their first Star Trek or something was their favorite Star Trek. Yeah. And something that comes along that's different is not going to be liked. That doesn't mean the criticisms aren't valid. I don't think the approach they're taking with Strange New Worlds is because they want to silence the critics who said it was too dark. They're doing it that way because they think it'll work better. The storytelling will work better that way.
Sure.
And I think they're right. I think if they're going to make the Pike show stand on its own, and if they're going to do something as very obviously retro as that, then doing it in the style of the original series in terms of plot, at least standalone plots, would work. I think something like what DS9 did and what the Stargate franchise did is having the character arcs develop from episode to episode, but having each episode be its own single story told in an hour, is I think the sweet spot for what they can do.
Well, and with Stargate too, you had a number of episodes that would call back to previous episodes without being a direct, you know, this to this to this to this episode by episode by episode. So you're able to kind of leapfrog the certain elements of plot. Now, speaking of Stargate and Star Trek, you've written tie-in fiction in a number of these worlds.
Well, 35, I think, at this point.
Well, yeah, because you've done Alien, you've done Supernatural, you've done X-Files. I mean, you Leverage, you've been all over the place, Buffy. Is there a particular approach when, because you mentioned Nicholas Meyer, when he comes in and he sits there and says, you know, I didn't know anything about Star Trek. I'm doing Star Trek 2. I watched all of the episodes. You know, he does his homework and he plays catch up. Whenever you do any kind of a tie-in fiction, have you had to be in that position where, you know, somebody approaches you and say, hey, Keith, you want to write a book in X universe? And you sit there and go, I don't know anything about it. But yeah, sure. What are your first steps in writing a tie-in book as opposed to original?
When that happens, whether I'm familiar with the project or not, my next step is to dive in and do immersive research. As an example, I was approached to do a novel based on Gene Roddenberry's Andromeda, the Kevin Sorbo show from the turn of the millennium. That I had seen maybe two episodes of the show, but the editor approached me because of the Farscape novel that I had done also for Tor Books. And he said, do you want to do an Andromeda novel? I said, sure. And then I sat down and binged it, which was harder in those days because we didn't have streaming services. But but I was able to, basically they sent, when I got the gig, they sent me VHS tapes of all the episodes to date. And I was able to get scripts of upcoming episodes as well. But I basically mainlined Andromeda up to that point. But that was in order to familiarize myself with it. However, if it's a project, if it's a property that I'm already familiar with, I do the same thing. When I did the Farscape comic book from 2008 to 2011 for Boom Studios, I did the same thing. Even though Farscape is one of my favorite shows and I've seen all the episodes multiple times, I still rewatched it again. When I got the Leverage assignment, same thing. I've been watching it religiously, but I wanted to get the world in my head. I wanted to get the character voices in my head. And also you watch it differently when you're writing a tie-in than you do when you're watching it just as a fan. You're paying attention to different things. You're paying attention to the character interactions. You're paying attention to the motivations of the characters.
Right.
You're paying attention to a lot of different things. And it can be gratifying. It's like where you see things that you're not, they haven't stated explicitly on the show, but look like a theme to you. And then later episodes make it clear that is a theme, that I got it right, so to speak. Perfect example. I did three Supernatural novels, and to me, Dean read as the kind of guy who in school was smart, but didn't want anyone to think he was smart. So he pretended to be stupid. I encountered this all the time, in high school myself. And especially because there were several occasions where Dean would pretend would act like he didn't know about something that he should damn well have known about. And Sam has to explain it to him, which was done in the script so that Sam could explain it to the viewer.
Sure.
But it also fits Dean's personality to my mind. Whereas Sam was the nerdy kid who always showed off exactly how smart he was all the time and didn't care if the other kids made fun of him for it. I put that in one of my books, and a few readers thought that was not a valid interpretation of them, except then later we saw them as kids and that's exactly what they were like. So obviously I was on the same wavelength as the people writing the show. You're not always. I mean, I'm sure plenty of readers can come up with instances where I got that wrong too. But and it's especially tough when you're dealing with an ongoing series, because things change over the course of the series, and also writing staffs change. So as an example, on Star Trek Voyager, Jerry Taylor was the showrunner for the first four seasons. And she wrote two novels that gave the backstories of the characters, Mosaic, which was Janeway's backstory, and Pathways, which was the rest of the cast's backstory.
Right.
Those backstories were followed while Taylor was the showrunner, but when she left after season four, her successors did not feel obligated to pay attention to those two novels at all. And so stuff would come up later that wound up contradicting it.
Well, and that was back in the day when it wasn't like Star Wars is now, where it's all canon. you know, the books, the Star Trek
book was never like that.
No, in terms of now.
I'm sorry. That argument annoys the crap out of me.
I don't mean the EU. I mean when Disney bought it and they set up their story group and they said from here on out, everything is going to be connected, everything's going to be canon. That was the general understanding. But with Star Trek, it never has been that way. The books have never been canon. So I think that's maybe a frustrating aspect of it for some fans to sit there and go, yeah, but you had all of this great stuff in these books. Why don't you ever use it? It's tough to keep track of all of that. And I imagine it's probably frustrating, too, because you've got to get to the status quo at the end of your book because you can't change anything that in the shows.
It doesn't bother me. I know the job was dangerous when I took it. And and also, even for all that Disney is saying that it all ties in together now, it still doesn't. The on-screen continuity will overwrite the tie-in continuity if they decide it does.
Yeah.
Which just happened a week ago on The Mandalorian, because Cobb Vanth's backstory in that episode of The Mandalorian is not the same as it was in Chuck Wendig's novel.
Right.
And that's always going to happen. It's the economics of scale. The needs of a TV show or a movie that reaches millions or billions of people is always going to overwrite the needs of a tie-in novel that reaches thousands and thousands of people.
Sure.
They're not going to alter a multi-million viewer TV show or movie to accommodate something that only less than 10% of the audience has read. And I know that.
Yeah.
And my fellow tie-in writers know that. Every once in a while, something winds up on screen. You know, Sulu and Uhura's first names both came out of tie-in fiction and wound up being canonized. There's some stuff from the Star Wars novel that has wound up on screen, including the planet Coruscant and any number of other things. For that matter, number one's first name of Una came out of the tie-in fiction.
Yeah.
It does happen. I don't stress about it because I don't stress about what's real in a fictional construct. Yes, the novels are not canon. The Marvel Cinematic Universe isn't canon either, but they still keep making those movies and people keep going to see them. Which version of Batman is real? Ben Affleck's or, Michael Keaton's or Robert Pattinson's or Adam West's or the one that's been in the comics since 1939?
I would say the answer to that is yes.
Right, exactly. we've had how many different versions of Sherlock Holmes over the last 20 years? None of which are consistent with each other, and none of which are consistent with Sir Arthur Conan Doyle entirely. But, and it still all works. It does. I don't think it matters.
Yeah.
As long as the stories are good, as long as the characters are still recognizable as themselves, if the details are different, the details are different. First Contact is still a great movie. The novel Federation is still a great novel. They tell two completely contradictory stories of Zefram Cochrane's life.
Yeah.
They're both still worthwhile. They're both still accepted as Star Trek stories. Only one of them is going to be referred to in other Star Trek productions, but that doesn't make Federation a bad novel, and it's still considered one of the best Trek novels that have ever been done.
Have you made a pitch for tie-in that didn't get made, and then somebody comes in and does something? You say, "Man, I could have done that better."
I probably, I can't think of a specific example now, but it happens. There's lots of parallel development. A perfect example, actually, and I don't think I did it better or worse. It just would have been repetitive if I had done it the way I originally pitched it. I pitched something for my Sleepy Hollow novel that I wrote, the Tom Meeson, Nicole Beharie show.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure.
From 6-7 years ago. I wrote what turned out to be the only tie-in to the show. And I pitched something involving a sword that could cast a magic sword, basically, that could cast a spell. They said, "Great, we love it. It's wonderful. Can't be a sword." Turns out they had their own magic sword story developing for season 2, so I had to make it something else. It worked out fine. In fact, it probably worked out better not being a sword, as it happened, because I was basing it on actual swords that were given away as in essence, medals, sword gifts to heroes of the revolution during the Revolutionary War.
Right.
There's one of those swords is actually in the Metropolitan Museum of Art here in New York, which is where I first found out about it. And by making it something else, by making it a metal cross with stuff inscribed on it, that freed me up to play around with it a little more and do it a little differently. So.
Now, the tie-in stuff that you've done, and then the original stuff that you've done, you mentioned the magic sword, the magic cross. You've got Dragon Precinct. You've got that series that involves magic and police. How many of those are you up to now?
There are 5 novels, plus 1 short story collection, and I've got a bunch more works of short fiction floating around in the ether, which will eventually be collected into a 2nd short story collection. I am currently one of the upcoming works I'm doing. I've had the basic plot for it, and I will be working on it soon. Is the 6th novel, which is called Phoenix Precinct. That I'm hoping to have that out in 2021, if all goes well. Since we're already in November of 2020, that may be optimistic. We'll see.
How long does it take you to go from pitch to publish?
Depends on how long they give me. Okay. I've taken as long as 6 months. I've taken as little as 10 days. The 10 days only happened once, and I'm eager to never repeat that. But and it was for a book that wound up not getting published, which made it even more annoying.
Oh yeah.
But my sweet spot is usually like 2 months. I could get it done faster depending. With the precinct books, they tend to go a little faster just because I'm really comfortable in that world and I love that world. And I usually can do that in like 6 weeks.
How easy is it for you to track your own world building? Have you got a giant spreadsheet? You got a big whiteboard?
I actually just discovered a continuity screw up in Mermaid Precinct that with a story I did afterward. Hmm. And I didn't quite get all the details right. Stuff happens. I try to keep track of it all, but it's hard.
Yeah.
Usually before I write a new story in the world, I sit down and do that same immersive research I was talking about before, and I read through everything, but sometimes stuff gets missed and it hasn't been anything like major. But it's frustrating when it happens, but you know, again, not stressing about what's real in a fictional construct.
Yeah.
So
is there a tie-in universe you haven't played in yet that you really, really would like to?
Oh, tons. Most of which I wouldn't get a chance to now because they're long defunct. I actually pitched a Highlander novel back in the day. Warner was doing Highlander tie-in novels, and there was one slot left. They had one book left in the contract. 3 people sent pitches in. I was one of them, but not the one that got picked. I would have loved to have written a Babylon 5 novel. I had an Ivanova novel that I wanted to pitch, but that never materialized. I wanted to write a Battlestar Galactica novel for the reboot. I was unable to pitch to that.
You may get another chance with that one because, you know, they're rebooting the reboot on TV and they're rebooting the rebooting and the reboot in the movies.
Yes, will be entertaining to see how that plays out. And the editor who basically I was told my services were not required because the editor only wanted to use real science fiction writers, which kind of pissed me off a little bit.
Real science fiction, like non tie-in writers?
Yes.
Or
yes, that was the idea, was people who didn't have a history writing tie-ins. Except one of the people he hired, two of the people he hired were Craig Shaw Gardner and Peter David, who have a huge history writing tie-ins.
Yeah.
But the editor in question felt I did not have enough of a resume of original work, whereas Peter and Craig did. Having said that, I would have loved to have written for that, like I said. I would have loved to have written a novel based on Homicide: Life on the Street, which is one of my favorite TV shows. But when they had tie-ins for that, they went with an Edgar Award-winning mystery author for some reason. So I couldn't really complain about it.
Sure.
And there are probably some others. The Librarians, I would have loved to have written. Greg Cox has written all of the tie-ins for that so far. And and honestly, I can't begrudge them that or him that. First of all, Greg is one of my oldest friends. Second of all, if I was an editor in charge of hiring somebody to write a Librarian's tie-in novel, Greg probably would be on the top of my list of people to contact.
Yeah.
So, his writing style is perfectly suited to that franchise. So,
I see a lot of different things on your bookshelf there, but I noticed you've got a David Weber book in there. He does a lot of collaborations now. Especially in the Honor Harrington, as that universe expands, and where have you? I, I'm I'm drawing a blank on how much collaboration you've done with other authors. Is that something that you would consider playing in somebody else's universe? Maybe not an IP, franchise, but...
Funny you should say that. I've actually got two novels coming out. One just got released and one is being released in January, which are collaborations where I'm working with... It's similar to what David's done with some of his collaborators. One of them, the one that just came out, is called To Hell and Regroup with David Sherman. That's a case where it's the third book in a trilogy. It's a military science fiction story. David wrote the first two books, Issue in Doubt and In All Directions. It's about an alien invasion of a human colony in the future. The first invasion wipes the colony completely out. The story of the trilogy is the response to that, which is the North American Union's Army, Navy, and Marines being sent to this colony to repel the invaders and drive them off. And David wrote the first two books, and I edited them originally. And then for a variety of personal and health reasons, David was unable to finish book three. And he asked me, since I was already familiar with it and because I had edited the first two books, he asked me to work with him to finish book three. So the third book is a collaboration between the two of us, but it's still very much David's book. My job there was just to be the relief pitcher, to finish the game for him, as it were, but it's still his win, as it were. So there's that. And that, like I said, that's very much David's thing. And that's me, in essence, acting as a tie-in writer. In David's 18th race milieu. I also wrote a book with Dr. Manish K. Batra, which is a thriller called Animal, which will be out from Wordfire Press in January. That's about a serial killer who targets people who harm animals. It's like Dexter if PETA had created it. And that, again, that is entirely Manish's story. He's working with me on it. You know, it's very much that's more of a direct collaboration, because I brought a lot more to the table than I did with David. David, I was just, you know, inserting myself into his world.
Sure.
In Manish's cases, he had the story is his, the plot is his, the overall theme is his. I worked with him on developing the specifics and several, although not all, of the characters I developed. The main characters are still very much his. The side characters we developed together, and other stuff that we worked on together. It's a much more organic collaboration than the stuff with David was. But I mean, in general, yes, obviously, because I just did two of them, I'm open to the idea. I'm writing more books with Munish. I'm revising another book that we put together called Pigman, which is a medical thriller, which is going to be shopped around to publishers soon.
Not to be confused with Paul Zindel's book. Right.
Yeah. Well, that I don't know if that's going to be the final title or not, but they almost never are.
Right.
But that's our working title at the very least.
Now, you mentioned editing. Is there a difference in your approach between editing and authoring? I mean, do you slip into one or the other when you're doing the other job, and you're just like, no, I can't think like an editor. I'm writing right now. Or you're an editor and you're like, no, I can't think like an author. Does that ever kind of start seeping into one to the other?
Usually. For the most part, yeah, I'm able to. The editing has not been happening as much lately, although that may change soon. My wife and I are in the process of starting up a small press because we're insane. And we're going to launch with a short story anthology, which we hope to be kickstarting soon. I've been saying that for months now, and we still haven't done it yet. Because 2020.
Sure.
But we're going to be starting up a small press called Whisperwood Press. It's not gonna be huge. We're just gonna be doing like an anthology every other year or so. So we're going to be editing that, and that's going to bring on the old editing muscles, but it's different. You know, when you're an editor, you're focusing on bringing out the best in the work. And that happens when I'm writing too sometimes, which is a good thing, because I want my work to be better. But that's you're trying to, when you're editing, you're trying to take what's there and improve it. And make sure it's clear, and make sure that the reader is getting what the author wants them to get. So they are two different things. They're related, but they're not exactly the same. And usually I can keep them separate. There's enough, the Venn diagrams overlap enough that it's they're both satisfying a creative urge. But it's good though, and it helps sometimes when I'm burned out on writing, editing something helps get me back into the swing of it, just to reset my brain a little bit.
Now, is this new imprint going to be something similar to like Crazy 8 Press, where you're finding different publishers to take the stories, or you're going to be a publisher yourself?
Crazy 8 Press isn't doing that. Crazy 8 Press is its own publisher.
Okay, I get the impression, because Bob Greenberger was on here. I got the impression, and I probably misunderstood this, that you have the imprint, and when Bob said finding publishers, I for some reason I got the sense that the two, it was, you have the label, you've got the Crazy 8 label, and various different publishers would publish Crazy 8 books. So I guess I had that wrong in my head.
No, that Crazy 8 publishes it themselves.
Okay, all right. Yeah. All right.
They have different imprints within Crazy 8, which is basically each individual author, more or less. Crazy 8 Press is sort of its own little collective thing. No, it's going to be a small press like eSpec Books, like Wordfire Press, and like Wildfire Press, and like any number of other presses, of which there are far too many for me to list here. But I mean, eSpec and Wildside and Prince of Cats are ones that I'm personally dealing with in some way or other, so they're ones that I'm mentioning. But no, there's tons of, and we're going to be like that, only much, much smaller.
You mentioned crowd.
I've got editorial experience. My wife does book production. So mm-hmm. Between the two of us, we have all the skills necessary.
Gotcha.
So we want to do for fun, and for likely very little profit.
Well, and speaking of that, you mentioned the crowdfunding for this first anthology, and we've seen, with Bob's stuff, the Thrilling Adventure Yarns anthologies have funded over there, and we've seen a number of comics and graphic novels going that route.
My publisher for the Precinct books is eSpec Books, and that's their business model. They kickstart every single one of their books.
So is that something that was always part of the plan, or is you just started to think, well, what's the best way to get this thing out in front of people, and you came upon that?
The reason why I'm doing it, the same reason why eSpec is doing it. Basically, the crowdfund gives you the upfront money you need to put the book together. And this way, that covers the initial production costs. It covers hopefully paying the authors. And that basically means everything after that is profit. You know, the idea is that the crowdfund enables you to cover the book production itself.
Sure.
And then every sale you make after that is pure money into everybody's pockets, into, you know, the authors and the publishers' pockets after that.
Now, we've seen a lot of these crowdfunding projects, especially over on the graphic novel side, the comic book side, where you have a lot of indie creators that have jumped into this over on both Kickstarter and Indiegogo, but now you're starting to see the recognized names that have been with DC and Marvel, people like Scott Snyder and Sean Gordon Murphy and that group. Kyle Higgins has got one going on right now. Is that, looking at, I'm not sure how much into the comics industry you are right now as a writer, as a creator, but is that the model going forward, or is that just one aspect of how the comics industry is going?
It's a model. I mean, it's comics has always been more friendly to independent creators than traditional book publishing. That's changed over the last 10 years, but it's another tool in the toolbox. It's another way to get stuff out to people, and it's a way, especially for graphic novels, because the production costs are way bigger. Anything with artwork in it is going to be more expensive to produce than anything that doesn't have artwork in it. And so using the crowdfund to help defray the costs and also help promote your product is win-win, really. Unless you don't make your funding, in which case you haven't lost anything except some time. I've successfully crowdfunded a whole bunch of works of short fiction. I've used Kickstarter and once Indiegogo also to do a crowdfund for a short fiction in the Dragon Precinct universe, And for that matter, I kickstarted Mermaid Precinct because I was between publishers at the time. And it's a good way to get your work in front of people, particularly if it's something that's kind of a niche product that may not necessarily have a huge mass market appeal, but for which there is still an audience.
Right.
Which is what, you know, Indian small press publishing is good for anyhow, is for giving a home to something that may not appeal to a Jagunda audience that you need for a mass market book, but still has an audience that still deserve to read the story. And you can still actually make a decent profit at it if it does well.
Well, and I think the other thing too on that is the question of sustainability. Like you're talking about with you know, doing books over and over and over again, every single book crowdfunding. We're starting to see that model where you have a lot of indie creators are now into their third or fourth graphic novel book in a series. Brian Polito's been doing it for years. We've seen, you know, Ethan and Skyver and Clint Stoker and a number of them have said, okay, here's the first book. Now here's the second one. Is that, you know, there's three or four in the pipeline now. It almost seems like this is... I've seen a lot of comparisons to Image Comics with this in terms of the kind of shift in the industry, in the mentality, because for a long while, crowdfunding didn't have the legitimacy aspect of it as it does now. I mean, it's people are taking it more seriously now than they used to, I think. Maybe.
Maybe in comics. In publishing and in gaming, it's been taken seriously for quite a while.
Yeah.
It's a perfectly legitimate way of doing things. As long as you actually fulfill your rewards, it's fine.
Sure.
It's been a very good way of developing all sorts of things creatively, not just books and comics. Like I said, books and games have been using Kickstarter for ages. I did my first Kickstarter in 2013.
Do you have a preference of Kickstarter over Indiegogo? Does it matter? Is there a particular reason why you use Kickstarter?
For the most part, Kickstarter has more visibility.
Yeah.
I switched to Indiegogo for one particular project for two reasons. One, that was at the time when Kickstarter was having some issues with unionizing, and I wasn't sure I wanted to keep using them. They have since settled that, for which I'm grateful. But also, that was one case where it didn't matter if I didn't make my funding. I prefer, for at least the projects that I have been doing, I prefer the model where if I don't make my funding, I don't have to actually then do the thing. the one and only Kickstarter or crowdfund that I have done that has failed was for a Dragon Precinct graphic novel. Like I said, anything with art, you need more money. And the artist that I wanted to use, I had to pay him. The amount I raised wouldn't have been enough. There were three aspects of the production, and I didn't cover any of them with the crowdfund, which was a lesson. And if I'd done that through Indiegogo, I would have been screwed because I wasn't even in any danger of making my funding. And there was a lesson in that I don't have enough of an audience to justify that high a crowdfund. So lesson learned, moving on. I'm sticking with pros because the margins there are much smaller. And you know, as long as you find a way that works and as long as you fulfill your rewards, at which I'm not always as speedy as I could be, as long as you stay in communication with your supporters, then it works. And hopefully it'll keep working. It'll keep working until it doesn't, because nothing lasts forever.
Yeah.
But it's like I said, it's another tool in the toolbox. I don't think it's going to replace anything. I think it's just supplementing all the other many methods of getting creative work out there.
Is the tie-in, because we talk about legitimacy on crowdfunding, and you mentioned some of the issues with being a tie-in writer as opposed to a legitimate fiction author.
That's less of an issue now, but.
Well, that's what I was going to say. It seems like that's kind of not as much of a thing as it used to be. I mean, you guys are still getting, has tie-in fiction gained a little bit more in terms of respectability, credibility? This is a legitimate form of storytelling, even though it's not your own universe?
Yes. That sea change has been happening over the course of my entire career, to be honest. And the person who said it to me when I was pitching the BSG novel surprised me, because I didn't think anybody still felt that way. And this was 15 years ago. At this point, yeah, it's not that big a deal. And also in my own case, I've got a lot more original stuff out now. Anyway, I've got, you know, 5 Precinct novels. I've got, you know, a bunch of other original stuff.
Sure.
I got another urban fantasy series that I'm working on right now. So, that I'm not just a tie-in writer anymore. You know, when I was rejected for the BSG franchise, I had precisely one original novel, the original publication of Dragon Precinct in 2004. And that was it. And the imprint that that was part of with Simon and Schuster had been discontinued. So I had no idea when I was going to do another one. So, but since then I've got an extensive, amount of original fiction. So it's not really a factor. Having said that, the stigma really doesn't, it still lingers in some bluff old traditionalists out there, I'm sure. But it's not as prevalent as it was, and it's become less and less prevalent with each passing year that I've been in the business.
Is that a generational thing, do you think? Or is that just, partly, it's wearing down over time? People are just starting to realize that it's just another way to tell a story.
Little column A, little column B. There's a part of the prevalence of it too, and the number of people. Also, the divide between screen science fiction and print science fiction is thinner than it used to be, partly because screen science fiction is so much more popular now.
Yeah.
You know, it was different when, you know, the only science fiction on the air was the occasional Star Trek show, and none of it was like when the movies based on Lord of the Rings became the most popular movies on the planet. That was a big change. You know, when comic book movies became the most popular movies in the world, that was a big change. The mainstream popularity of things like the X-Files in the 90s and the Star Trek spinoffs also in the 90s, and just the proliferation of science fiction on screen, and you're now getting people in the field who grew up with this, who grew up with in a world where the best science fiction isn't just the books.
Right.
The best science fiction is everywhere. It's the comic books, it's the movies, it's the TV shows, and it's the books. It's a much more multimedia focused society. So you're also getting more tie-in fiction that where the people involved in making the product are more invested in the tie-ins.
Right.
I did a Heroes Reborn novella back in 2015 when NBC revived Heroes for that miniseries. I worked directly with the showrunner on that one. That never happens. Usually because the showrunner is too busy running the show to actually pay attention to the tie-in fiction. But in that case, they were very invested in making sure that the novellas that we did 6 novellas that tied into the series, and they all tied in very closely and were accurate.
Yeah.
You know, I worked with the creator of Farscape on the Farscape comics. You know, John Rogers himself approved the plots for the Leverage novels that came out in 2014 or 2013, and so on. You know, the people involved in making the stuff we're tying into are more invested in the tie-in fiction than they used to be, and that's made the tie-ins better. You know, people like to write them and people like to read them, and there's less of a stigma on doing things you enjoy.
Oh, sure. Well, and I know, let me ask you about this, because you talk about the everything kind of becoming this multimedia thing where it's all of a piece. There have been a number of different places I've seen the comment. It seems now, because we get news items pretty much every week, that we do on Saturday, you know, we do our Saturday morning news roundup, and every week I'm getting stories of books that have been optioned for adaptation. We've got comic books that get optioned, you know, Why the Last Man's in production now, and all of these things. And the flip side of that, the criticism is, you know, it seems like you're writing the book in order to get the movie deal. Is that a concern overall, or should authors be that wrapped up in prioritizing the adaptation deal, or is it just, let's just tell the story in the book, we'll worry about the rest of it later? Because it seems like it's a mix at this point.
The number of books that are written compared to the numbers that actually get adapted is a fraction.
Sure. Yeah.
And just because something is optioned doesn't mean it's going to happen. I know several people who have gone through the process of their books being optioned and then developed. Honestly, it amazes me that any movie or TV show ever gets made at all, given all the obstacles that are in place. It's a shot in the dark, and you don't know if it's going to happen or not. And even, you know, I've read all those news stories too, and 90% of them are never actually going to make it to the screen for one reason or another.
Yeah.
It's great for the writer because it's more money and it's more exposure. Even the worst adaptation of a book that comes out will drive sales. The Sci-Fi Channel did a TV version of the Dresden Files a bunch of years ago.
Sure. Yep. With Paul Blackthorne.
It was not great. It had some problems, but it still sales spiked on the book because there was a TV show.
Yeah.
You do a movie based on a book, and sales of the book are going to spike, even if it's a terrible movie that nobody likes. Even if it's a movie that doesn't do well, the book still benefits from
it. Now No, that's okay. The flip side of that, people are looking at, you mentioned the Marvel movies, the superhero films. It doesn't seem like that comic book sales have benefited all that much from the superhero movies being out there. Is that an odd discrepancy? Why do you think that is?
No, because the distribution for comic books has been weird for a very long time. And the primary method of delivery of new comic book stories is a method that you have to like work a lot harder to get to.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's changed with the development of online sales or not. I don't know enough one way or the other. You know, I don't know.
What about Alan Moore's comments about superhero movies basically kind of corrupting all of the entertainment media that we've got here? I think
Moore is a cranky old man who's I don't take particularly seriously. Great writer, but art is art. I don't think it's corrupting anything. And I don't think creating something that a lot of people enjoy and like is a bad thing. You know, one of my least favorite phrases is guilty pleasure. As long as something isn't actually actively harming somebody, you should absolutely have no guilt about taking pleasure from it.
Yeah.
I can't stand the Twilight books, but the fact that they're popular, I don't think is a bad thing. Because people enjoy them. If people enjoy them, good. They should enjoy them. Art is art, and art is a worthwhile thing. There's nothing inherently noble about appealing to fewer people, you know. And I don't see anything wrong. You know, lots of people. The reason why the superhero movies do well is because there have been a lot of really good superhero movies that are very entertaining that a lot of people like. That isn't bad.
Yeah.
One could argue it's corrupted, but it also, if it wasn't for superhero movies, we would not have gotten the version of Much Ado About Nothing that Joss Whedon did. Because the only reason he was able to do it is because of the cachet he got from Avengers. It's enabled a lot of actors to then do other work and directors to raise their profile. A lot more people have heard of Taika Waititi because he directed a Thor movie. A lot more people have heard of Patty Jenkins because she directed a Wonder Woman movie. That's good for them.
Yeah.
That means that down the line, they can do other projects that may not make as much money, but which are worthwhile in terms of art. And this is good, you know. I would much rather make all my money off of the Dragon Precinct books, but that's not realistic because I don't have the kind of audience that does that. But if writing an alien novel drives some people to then check out my Precinct book, that's good. Yeah. That helps me. That's how it works. And I don't see it. I think calling it a corrupting influence is ridiculous.
Well, now the idea here of appealing to a smaller audience, it brings up a question about the Hugos, where you see the participation numbers going down. We were at WorldCon in 2016, when it was here in Kansas City, and one thing we noticed, a lot of the people attending the WorldCon are in an older generation, and you know, we're seeing that kind of thing continue. Is the literary side of science fiction, in terms of the Hugos and the Nebulas and the Saturns, all of those, is that group, I don't want to couch this as an us versus them thing, but the people who have a vested interest in the Hugos, it seems to be that group is dwindling. How do we
the Hugos increase interest? The Hugos are always a niche. The Hugos are the books that are considered best by a subsection of a subsection of a subsection. The people who go to world cons are a subsection of people who go to conventions at all, because it's expensive and there's right. a lot of people who can't, you know, or can't travel or whatever. That people who go to conventions are a subsection of the actual readership. I always remind people that organized fandom is only a small handful of the actual readership. Has to be. If it wasn't, we'd all have gone out of business by now.
Yeah.
I always give my parents as an example. I read science fiction and watch science fiction because of my parents. They're the ones who were into it in the first place. My parents never had any even awareness of organized fandom. That doesn't make them any less science fiction readers. So the Hugos, like I said, it's a subset of a subset of a subset.
Yeah.
And because most people who go to Worldcon don't vote in the Hugos either. So it's not really that, it was never that great a barometer in the first place. I mean, yes, a lot of great works have gotten Hugos, but there's a lot of stuff that gets missed. My view on awards, I've been involved in too many awards to really take any of them seriously. my feeling on them is getting one is great, not getting one is meaningless.
Yeah.
In either direction. It is indeed an honor to be nominated because it means someone noticed you. It doesn't mean not getting one doesn't mean you're not any good. It just means that it didn't get noticed by this particular group of people. I don't think it's as much of an issue with the Nebulas because the Nebulas are voted on by science fiction writers or by members of the Science Fiction Writers of America. So it depends on the membership.
Sure.
But at least there it's a jury of your peers, as it were. The Scribe Awards for the International Association of Media Tie-In Writers are the same thing. That's a case where, like I said, getting an award is great. But if you never get an award, and I've received precisely one award, which I had to share. It was a tie for best short story from the Scribes. That's it. And an anthology, I was in one best anthology, but it was an anthology that had like 100 stories in it. And mine was one. That is the full extent of my award winning. If I won more, it'd be great. If I don't win another one ever again, I don't care. It doesn't matter that much. It's a nice acknowledgement, and it certainly doesn't hurt.
Sure.
But not getting an award.
You talk about the people who don't attend conventions.
Yeah.
And now in
which is a lot more people than the ones who did.
Yeah, well, and a lot more people now don't attend now that everything's shut down. But once conventions start up again, now we've been tracking since March 15th when we started reporting on various different schedule changes for everything. We're so far, I think, up to about 1,400 events that have either canceled or they've rescheduled or they've rescheduled and canceled or they've postponed or they've gone virtual. They've said, oh, okay, we're going to do a different. We have over 2,100 events worldwide on our list that we track, and it seems to me that moving forward from here, all of them are going to have to figure out some kind of an online virtual component, I would think. Does it make sense for at least the bigger events, things like San Diego or New York or Dragon Con or any of those, to have a virtual online element that's planned?
Yeah, I think it's a great idea. It's good for people who can't travel. It's good for people who have various disabilities. It's good for people who have anxiety in crowds.
Yeah.
It's good for people who, you know, have back surgery and can't make the convention. It's good for people who, you know, there's so many ways that it can, that having a virtual component can bring more people to the show in one way or another. I mean, there's still aspects of the show you can't replicate. It's been really hard to replicate a dealer's room.
Yeah.
That's been the worst aspect of this is the inability for vendors to really be able to sell things there's a lot of people who make most of their money off of selling at conventions. You know, I know of several vendors at Dragon Con who depend on Dragon Con for the vast majority of their yearly income, and they got screwed this year.
Yeah.
And that aspect of it, you know, still requires a certain level of in-person, you know, interaction. But I think certainly in terms of programming, there's a lot of ways that this, all the virtual conventions that we've seen and the virtual panels and such, can be utilized even once we can gather in large groups again safely. That'll be, like I said, it'll be good for everybody. It means more people can participate, which is never a bad thing.
I watched some of Dragon Cons. I watched some of Comic Con at home. I didn't
see any of the Comic Con stuff, but I participated in a bunch of the Dragon Con.
It seems like Dragon Con has a better handle on it than Comic Con, which is really surprising because San Diego, you would think, you know, it's this huge, massive thing, and it's all these media and Hollywood types that come in. You would think that they'd be able to get this, and it doesn't seem like Comic Con at home did very well at all.
Because
the viewer numbers are only, you know, 100 here, 20 here, 300 here. Yeah. The videos aren't playing very well. Now, DC Fandome knocked it out of the park, I thought. And Dragon Con had the three different tracks where you had the live stuff going on now, you had the fan tracks, and you had all
Dragon
the past
Con,
stuff.
Dragon Con had the advantage of spreading around the work. Because a lot of the tracks were doing stuff as well. And some of the tracks actually had been doing stuff leading up, like the American Sci-Fi Classics track had been doing quarantine panels leading up to that. So they already had it all down pat. Some tracks did better than others, but because with Comic-Con at home, it was the same group of people managing the entire thing. Whereas, Dragon Con was able to, because that's how Dragon Con set up. Dragon Con isn't so much one convention, it's about 25 smaller conventions all under one roof.
Well, sure.
Six roofs. Yeah. But, and so they could, the work was spread around a little more, which I think helped them. And also there were different levels of things at Dragon Con. You know, Comic Con at home was almost entirely actor driven. Because that's what's going to bring eyeballs. But I don't know. One of the other issues with virtual conventions, of course, that you can't do in person is autographs. And Comic-Con is more geared toward the stargazing, you know, see them talk and then get their autograph afterward than Dragon Con is.
Right.
Autographs are only a very small part of Dragon Con, whereas it's a huge part of San Diego. So that I think might have been a factor too. That's another thing which you know, is harder to recreate in a virtual, impossible really to create in a virtual atmosphere. You can't really, you know, do an autograph line over Zoom. And I think that affected Comic-Con also. But there's ways. I mean, I've done a whole bunch of conventions this year over Zoom, you know, this way we did Heliosphere that way. We did Balticon, Rubonicon, Capclave, Shoreleave, DragonCon, and a bunch of them have continued to do things. Several of the DragonCon tracks have continued to do panels, like the Urban Fantasy track at DragonCon has been doing weekly looks at the previous week's episode of Supernatural. I was on one on Monday. The Sci-Fi Classics track has been continually doing quarantine panels. And some of the others, I think, are doing stuff as well. So it's still, and Shoreleave has been doing a panel every month just to give everybody a chance to see each other and to communicate with each other and talk to each other.
Well, and it seems like this also seems like it gives these various different events, from a marketing side, you're raising awareness throughout the year on the various different things that you're doing.
Yes.
I guess the danger on that is you've got to make sure that what you're doing online doesn't necessarily take away from doing the actual physical event. I mean, once we get back to doing events, and I don't think it will.
Like I said, you don't have the same level of social interaction over Zoom and Discord that you get in person.
Yeah.
And you don't, you know, the meetings and the camaraderie, you still need that. Like I said, what this will do is open it up to people who, for whatever reason, can't do that. And I think that's only a good thing. We're already starting to see that a lot, like conventions, like Dragon Con and World Con did a joint thing when World Con was in Chicago and over Labor Day weekend, where they did some joint panels.
Right.
We had like five people in Chicago and five people in Atlanta. Some like the last couple of Discworld conventions, Terry Pratchett did those via Skype. Both Tom Baker and Leonard Nimoy have done media conventions over Skype because they couldn't really travel, and so on. And I think now that we're getting to the point where we're going to see a lot more of that, where we'll see guests who can't travel for whatever reason still be able to attend a show to an extent,
yeah,
by doing something over Zoom or over Skype or over Google Hangouts or whatever the program of choice is, which again is only a good thing, particularly, you know, with some actors and authors who are getting older, for whom, you know, the stress of a convention is really not something they can deal with anymore, but still enable them to interact with their with their fellow authors and their fans and their readers and their viewers.
Well, and that's one of the things that we've tried to do with some of our stuff. When we we're live out at an event, you know, we broke new ground with what we did at WorldCon, and people were asking us, is this the new model? Is this what you guys are going to do? And it's like, well, we'd love to do this at different events. But the other aspect of it is when we go to some place like Star Wars Celebration and we're walking around and we're just broadcasting from the floor, say, oh, hey, here's a booth, here's a booth, here's a booth, look at this. And people are sitting there saying, you know, we're basically by proxy letting them see what's at the event. It's right, almost as if they're there, but not quite. So if we have some sort of a mix of those different things that we bring to the table, but then you've got, you know, people like yourself, and you've got, you know, a YouTube channel, and you've got all of, yes, these different things. And we've talked, I've talked to a number of people about the idea that authors have to do a lot more of their own marketing, and you're doing readings here on your YouTube channel. Some people seem to grasp it a little bit better than others. But you know, hopefully maybe this kind of thing where we're online and we're doing these kind of programs, this kind of interaction with the creators of the thing maybe helps kind of get people used to the we can do it this way and still bring value to the conversation about stuff.
Oh, sure.
So, all right, so what's coming out next for you?
Well, I mentioned the two most recent books, Animal and To Hell and Regroup. To Hell and Regroup is now on sale from eSpec Books, in trade paperback or ebook form. There's also an omnibus called The 18th Race Omnibus, which collects all three books, Issue and Doubt, In All Directions, and To Hell and Regroup, all in one big quivering mass. Those are, again, available from eSpec Books. There is my very terrible website, which will not be a terrible website for much longer.
Wait, you're actually going to update this? This is almost very retro at this point here, Keith.
I know. No, I'm working with a web designer. We've already started talking. She recently bought a house, so we have to, the working on the website was put on hold while she moved. But the plan is hopefully to launch the new site in 2021. But I've got, like I said, Animal and To Hell and Regroup are due out soon. I'm working right now on the second Brom Gold adventure, which is going to be called Feet of Clay, which is my urban fantasy series about a guy from the Bronx who hunts monsters for a living. And my next book with Dr. Batra, my collaborator on Animal, is another one we're almost done with. I'm just doing final revisions on it. I've got a short story coming out in the Horns and Halos anthology, which is coming out from eSpec Books. That is a story. It's about half stories about angels and half stories about demons. And mine is a story that features a woman named Yolanda Rodriguez, who is in the same setting as the Brom Gold books. She is a supernatural hunter for hire. That same character already appeared in an anthology that came out earlier this year called Badass Moms, which was from Crazy Eight Press, edited by Mary Fan, which is a very self-explanatory anthology. Is it about moms who are badass?
Sure.
And I really fell in love with that character, and I'm continuing to use her. She's also going to be in the next Brom Gold book that I'm writing right now. And what else? I've got, and then I'm going to be working on Phoenix Precinct, which is the next book in the Precinct series. And I've got a crowdfund story that I need to actually write. Cassie Zukov's story, my urban fantasy series set in Key West, which are only short stories. I haven't done any novels with her, but there's a, and once I've written that story, which is called Ragnarok in a Hard Place, I should have enough to do a second collection. The first 9 Cassie Zukov stories were in a collection called Ragnarok and Roll. And I now have enough stories at this point to do a second collection, or I will when I finish this last story, which will be called Ragnarok in a Hard Place. And I've also got the International Association of Media Tie-In Writers is putting together an anthology called Turning the Tide, spelled T-I-E-D, which is going to be a charity anthology that will, and I honestly don't remember who it's benefiting now, crap, and I was part of the discussions with this too, but it's going to be a charity anthology featuring, it's all going to be tie-in stories with characters who are in the public domain. So we don't have to pay any rights.
I think I remember hearing something about that, yes. Yeah. When is that supposed to be come out?
I think we're shooting for the spring of 2021. The stories themselves are due December 15th, giving people time to be late and all sorts of other stuff and editing and such. Figure spring or summer of 2021.
Okay.
Depending on how timely we all are with turning our stories in. Mine is going to feature Aisha from the H. Rider Haggard novel She.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, when that one comes out, be sure to let us know about that because we can have you back on to talk about it. And then, of course, your crowdfunding anthology that you're starting.
That'll be called the 4 question mark of the apocalypse, or the 4 fill in the blank of the apocalypse.
Well, when that's ready to go.
You've heard about the horsemen. These are going to be the 4 everything else.
Ah, okay. So, all right. Well, we will definitely have you back on for that.
We'll get it out.
All right. Well, Keith DeCandido, thank you very much for being here today. DeCandido.
My pleasure.
Net is the website, and you can check that out. We will put a link in the show notes here. And for those of you who are interested in getting one of our nice little stickers here, or if you have material you want to send us to review, we do have a mailing address. It's 1503 Main Street, number 305, Grandview, Missouri, 64030. And, of course, we do invite you to subscribe. And you can find us on all of the different social media. You can see that there. And, of course, on your way out, if you want to leave us a thumbs up and maybe share the link with your cohort, we do appreciate that as well. That's going to do it for us today. Thanks very much for watching. Thanks very much for being in the chat. You can leave a comment, feedback. You can send us an email, livefromthebunker@scififorme.com. Good morning, Multiverse, Saturday morning at 10 a.m. Eastern. And... don't forget, it's a cookbook. Have a good weekend, folks.
Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Copyright 2020 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. Delivering the multiverse since 2009. This is Sci-Fi for Me TV.